Tourism for Climate Action. My name is Virginia Trapa, and today I speak on behalf of the One Planet Sustainable Tourism Program. It is a pleasure for us to bring back the discussion on tourism to the Blue Zone of UNFCCC Conference of the Parties, and I would like to thank the organization for that. Transforming tourism sector is needed to embrace a low carbon pathway. Today, policymakers will discuss strategic approaches to enhance ambition, and the report, Transport-Related CO2 Emissions of the Tourism Sector, will also be launched. Without further ado, I would like to invite to the podium to deliver opening remarks Mr. Orvais Sarmad, Deputy Executive Secretary of UNFCCC.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Great pleasure for me to be here. First of all, I'd like to acknowledge the Director General of World Trade Organization, World Tourism Organization, I'm sorry, the Secretary of State for Tourism, and other distinguished guests, Ambassador Colette from France. Great pleasure to see you here. I'll be very brief and very specific in what I would like to share with you. First, I'd like to put the discussion and what you're going to be hearing today in the context and share some remarkable set of numbers. To say that tourism sector is an economic powerhouse is something of an understatement. And why is that? Because in 2018, this industry, the tourism industry, generated an outstanding 10% of the global GDP, which is almost $9 trillion. That is on the plus side of the ledger. If we were talking about the ledger on both sides of accounting, if you like, this has meant creation of millions of jobs around the world, including, of course, in particular in the developing world. According to the World Travel and Tourism Council, one in five of all jobs newly created in 2017 were attributable to travel and tourism. In fact, the sector was responsible for creation of 7 million new jobs worldwide, and it grew almost 5% or 50% faster than the global economy around the world. And of course, countless other millions have been able to explore new destinations, reunite with family and friends, and fulfill their dreams in exploring the world. However, in terms of climate impact, there has been a substantial minus side to that positive numbers that I presented. A recent study published in the Nature Climate Change, led by an international team of scientists, looked at the overall impact of all areas of tourism sector, and they found out that it accounts for 8% of the world's greenhouse gas emissions. This number is simply not sustainable if we hope to limit the global temperature rise to 1.5 degrees by the end of the century. With such extraordinary footprint, representing profit and pleasure on the one side, and equal amount, or in fact, maybe greater than that, pain on the other side, where do we go from here? The truth of the matter is that if we do not take control of climate change, it will certainly impact the tourism sector in very negative ways. All of those jobs, the travel options I just mentioned before, will disappear under the weight of fires, floods, droughts, and hurricanes, and relentless heat waves that we all are experiencing in many parts of the world, all of which are playing out on our television screens every day and on the nightly news on almost on a regular basis. The creation of jobs, homes, hopes, and dreams all get dashed under the onslaught of such catastrophic climate events. And I know that both for UNWTO and WTTC, these concerns are of major preoccupation. It is critical that we all work together at all levels to help the industry take more ambitious action. And this is why we're here in Madrid for this COP, to take ambitious action, to remind everyone, all sectors of the society, the government, the public sector, the private sector, especially the corporations. And in this regard, I should point out that while tourism is mentioned in many NDCs, nationally determined contributions, is a big concern, not enough has yet been done. Industry must do more, but governments must align their policies so that at international level we can collectively work to increase ambition in this regard. I take great comfort, though, in the efforts that the World Tourism Organization, UNEP, the German and the French governments, and various other stakeholders are putting forth to accelerate responses in the tourism sector with respect to its impact on climate change. So I thank you for putting on this international conference in tandem with our COP25. The One Planet Sustainable Tourism Program is a vital or ongoing mechanism to promote sustainable tourism around the world. I would be remiss if I did not also note that unchecked tourism can have major implications for the achievement of many of the SDGs, including, of course, SDG number 12, where the program is recognized as an implementation mechanism. All of which reinforces the evidence which shows that climate change impacts almost everything and that unprecedented transitions are needed very, very quickly. I consider that your deliberations at this conference will be very useful, to be of utmost importance, particularly as they might relate to the overall intent and the implementation of the Paris Agreement, including initiatives focused on decoupling tourism growth from the increased use of natural resources. So I thank you very much for your attention, and I look forward to a very good discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Sarmat. I would like to invite Mr. Manuel Butler, Executive Director of UNWTO, for his opening remarks. Mr. Butler.
Deputy Executive of UNFCCCC, Secretary of State of Spain, Secretary of State of Argentina, President of the WTTC, esteemed colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, let me apologize for the absence of my SG, Turapolo Likashvili, against his will, due to last-minute commitments, he can attend this event. Thank you for joining us at this COP25 site event supporting tourism as a driver for a better, more sustainable world. This climate change summit is the biggest and most important high-level event dedicated to the defining issue of our time, and in an honor to be part of it. Representing the power of tourism, the third largest sector in the world. As UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres has told world leaders, don't bring a speech about climate change, bring a plan to address it. That is exactly what we hope to do with the launch of this new report. This is the first comprehensive study into the environmental impact of the different types of transport within the tourism sector. With this empirical evidence, we can identify where tourism is contributing to the sustainability agenda. It can also show us where we can improve as a sector. It is now up to all the tourist value chain, from national governments to local operators, to use this data effectively. The challenge we face is to ensure that tourism keeps growing and keeps delivering many benefits to people and communities around the world, leaving nobody behind. At the same time, however, we need to decouple this growth from the carbon emissions produced by the sector, including by transport. COP25 is our opportunity to work together to transform this agreement into meaningful action. UNWTO is proud to lead the efforts of the global trade sector to deliver on climate response. Together, we can take another big step towards low carbon travel, guaranteeing the opportunities tourism can bring are enjoyed by future generations and that the sector works for both people and planet. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Butler. We're now starting the second part of our side event, the panel discussion. I would like, therefore, to invite to join me here in the podium the moderator today, Dr. Dirk Lesser, Director of the Sustainable Development of Tourism Department at UNWTO. And I would also like to invite all our distinguished speakers to join us here in the podium because we're going to take a group photo here before we start the panel discussion. While we are taking the photo, a housekeeping announcement. There is one of the speakers that will be delivering the speech in French. So for those that need interpretation, the headsets are at the back of the room. Thank you.
Allow me to introduce to you the panelists of our discussion. We are pleased to have Ms. Brigitte Collet, the French Ambassador for Climate, Mr. Carlos Gentil, Secretary of State for Climate Change and Sustainable Development of Argentina, and Chair of the Board of Directors of the One Planet Network, Ms. Isabel Olivier, Secretary of State for Tourism of Spain, and Mr. Wills Agricol, the Principal Secretary for Energy and Climate Change of Seychelles, is represented by Angelique Pompono, the CEO of Seychelles Conservation and Climate Adaptation Trust Fund. Today we launch the report on the carbon emissions related to the transportation of tourism. This report is updating the figures since in 2008 UNWTO published the carbon footprint for the tourism sector. The report was aimed at being actionable. This is why we have concentrated on the most important element of tourism carbon emissions, the transportation perspective. We here have the QR code so that you can now download the full entire report. Important is to see that we have concentrated not only on identifying how the tourism sector is currently doing, but in cooperation with the International Transportation Forum at OECD, our focus was how does the current ambition look like for the year 2030. All the results we are presenting here today are aimed at explaining what the current ambition reflects for the tourism sector. The aim is for us to encourage the tourism sector, those representing the private and public representatives of the tourism sector, to move to a high ambition scenario. First of all, you will see here the results. In 2016, the tourism sector globally represented 20 billion trips. 1.2 billion of those trips were international tourist arrivals. It was for us very important to underline that additional dimension of domestic and same-day tourism and visitors. I repeat, 20 billion trips, out of which 18.8 billion were domestic and same-day visitors. As we heard before, tourism at the same time represents 10% of GDP and 1 out of 10 jobs around the globe. In 2030, we estimate that we count with a total of 37 billion trips, out of which 1.8 billion will be international tourist arrivals and 35.6 domestic and same-day visitors. By then, it is estimated that tourism is representing 11.5% of GDP. To put the tourism sector's footprint into perspective, we see the transportation-related carbon emissions of tourism, 1,597 million tons in 2016. This is 5% out of the 32,132,100 million man-made emissions. These 5% are just representing the transportation-related emissions. I recall that this, in 2008, when we studied the emissions for 2005, the proportion for transportation out of the overall emissions of tourism were an estimated 75%. In 2030, we estimate that out of the 37,800 million man-made emissions, 1,998 million will be linked to tourism transportation. This is an increase of 25% over the 2016 levels and represents by then, against the current ambition, 5.3% out of all man-made emissions. To look deeper into the proportions and specify the relevance of tourism transportation out of overall transportation, we prepared this slide. In 2016, transportation was responsible for 7,230 million tons. That means for the 1,597 tons that tourism represents, 22% out of the transportation-related emissions. and 2030, transportation-related emissions are expected to be at 8,707 million tons, out of which 21% are tourism transportation-related. These are just some of the findings we wanted to share with you here today on the occasion of this event, where we count on representatives from the public sector developing tourism policies and having the opportunity together, based on evidence, to transform the tourism sector. The aim of our discussion here is to identify now instruments, policies, which we have to prioritize so that we are turning the tourism sector to a sector with a high ambition. I have now the pleasure to invite our first panelist to deliver the presentation, Ms. Brigitte Collet, the French Ambassador for Climate.
Is it on? Okay. So I am the one who's going to be speaking in French. Merci beaucoup pour votre invitation à participer à ce panel. Le secteur du tourisme et sa relation avec le climat est en effet un sujet extrêmement important, et les chiffres que vous venez de rappeler le soulignent très très bien. Pour nous, France, ce secteur a un rôle à jouer dans la lutte contre les changements climatiques. Les objectifs climatiques devraient, à notre sens, être davantage intégrés dans les politiques publiques qui encadrent le secteur du tourisme. Et d'un autre côté, les stratégies nationales de lutte contre le changement climatique devraient intégrer davantage le secteur du tourisme. Ce que je voudrais faire, c'est partager quelques éléments de notre expérience nationale, car, comme vous le savez sans doute, la France est la première destination mondiale de touristes, et ce depuis 1980. Le nombre de touristes visitant notre pays, et nous en sommes très heureux et très, très fiers, a considérablement augmenté, et en 30 ans, en fait, il a triplé, passant de 30 millions en 1980 à 90 millions en 2018, et nous allons vers les 100 millions. Tout cela pour une population qui est actuellement de 67 millions de personnes. Cette expansion importante du tourisme fait peser sur nous des responsabilités au regard de nos engagements climatiques. Nous devons veiller à ce que cette augmentation de visiteurs en France ne nous empêche pas d'atteindre nos objectifs, les objectifs de l'accord de Paris. C'est pourquoi nous devons fortement nous engager pour que toutes les formes de tourisme prennent en compte l'impact du tourisme sur l'environnement. Et là, il y a un secteur qui nous paraît absolument fondamental, c'est celui de l'accès aux données et aux informations sur l'impact du tourisme sur l'environnement. Nous devons au maximum mettre les touristes en capacité de mesurer eux-mêmes quels sont les impacts de leurs pratiques en termes d'émissions de gaz à effet de serre. Nous devons par ailleurs pouvoir mesurer précisément quelles sont les contributions aux émissions de chaque composante du tourisme, transport, hôtellerie, restauration. Et ça, c'est très important si l'on veut être en mesure de fixer des objectifs chiffrés pour chaque secteur. Le ministère français de la transition écologique et solidaire s'est beaucoup impliqué sur différents projets d'affichage environnemental pour permettre aux consommateurs de savoir ce que leurs achats induisent en termes d'émissions. Une méthode de mesure a été déployée pour l'hôtellerie grâce à l'Agence française de l'environnement et à des entreprises partenaires. Et actuellement, plus de 250 hôtels participent à la démarche. L'étiquette indiquant les émissions de gaz à effet de serre est expérimentée maintenant dans les restaurants et puis aussi dans les campings. L'objectif est que cette étiquette environnementale soit diffusée auprès de tous les métiers du tourisme. C'est à notre avis ce type de démarche innovante que nous devons soutenir et développer pour l'ensemble du secteur du tourisme. Et l'objectif final, c'est de pouvoir mesurer l'impact d'un séjour complet en termes d'émissions de gaz à effet de serre. Par ailleurs, il nous semble fondamental de lutter contre le gaspillage alimentaire. Nous savons qu'il contribue fortement au réchauffement climatique, peut-être pour 8% des émissions mondiales de CO2. Et donc, nous avons lancé en France une politique ambitieuse pour la lutte contre le gaspillage alimentaire, avec un pacte national, avec une loi sur ce sujet. Il y a beaucoup d'innovations actuellement dans ce secteur, applications sur smartphone, dons, achats en vrac. Or, l'agroalimentaire a une place importante dans la chaîne de valeur du tourisme. Et nous pensons donc que là aussi, le secteur du tourisme peut jouer un grand rôle pour lutter contre le gaspillage alimentaire. Nous pensons en fait que le tourisme est un formidable vecteur pour interroger des habitudes qui ont des conséquences négatives sur le climat. Il y a aussi la question des achats durables. Peut-être pourrais-je citer un exemple d'une entreprise partenaire du programme Tourisme Durable, c'est le Club Med, qui a développé un beau projet d'approvisionnement alimentaire durable dans plusieurs de ses sites, au Sénégal, au Maroc, au Brésil et en Indonésie, en général en coopération avec des ONG locales. Toujours concernant l'achat durable, un exemple plus récent peut-être, celui de l'entreprise française Betterfly Tourism, qui est partenaire du programme Tourisme durable du réseau One Planet. Elle a développé dans l'ouest de la France un programme pour contrôler, à travers l'achat durable, l'impact environnemental des serviettes et du linge utilisés dans les hôtels. Et son constat est que l'achat du linge produit localement, non blanchi et ayant une composition qui le rend plus léger que le linge standard, a permis de réduire les émissions de 32%. Et d'utiliser 42% de moins d'énergie et de limiter également la consommation en eau de 28%. Voilà, c'était un exemple d'innovation assez nombreuse dans ce secteur. Je dirais que si la France est impliquée dans le programme Tourisme durable du réseau One Planet depuis son lancement en 2014, c'est pour que ce type de bonne pratique puisse être dupliqué à un niveau global. Le partage d'expériences nous paraît absolument crucial. Nous croyons aussi beaucoup aux coalitions d'acteurs engagés sur des actions concrètes. Et j'aimerais en mentionner une qui a été lancée à l'occasion du sommet du G7 de Biarritz en août dernier. C'est la déclaration de Nulakita sur la décarbonation du secteur du transport maritime. Les pays signataires s'y engagent à réduire de 40% d'ici 2030 les émissions de CO2 par activité de transport. Or, naturellement, dans le domaine du tourisme, nous savons que de gros progrès sont à faire avec un point de vigilance particulier pour les émissions des bateaux de croisière qui ont un très fort impact sur l'environnement. Voilà, et je me permets de lancer l'idée que les trois chefs de file du programme Tourisme durable, l'Espagne, la France, l'Organisation mondiale du tourisme, pourraient être moteur pour accompagner les acteurs du secteur des navires de croisière vers une transition bas carbone. Enfin, vraiment pour conclure, je crois que nous avons tous une responsabilité dans cette bataille pour le climat. Nous devons adopter des démarches dont nous mesurons les impacts en termes d'émissions de gaz à effet de serre. Nous devons aussi, et c'est très enrichissant, partager nos expériences, communiquer sur ce que nous faisons et apprendre des autres, comme nous le faisons grâce à ce panel aujourd'hui. Et je dirais, d'une certaine manière, c'est le fondement de la démarche du tourisme. C'est découvrir, partager, s'enrichir de la connaissance d'autres lieux, d'autres cultures et d'autres pratiques. Je vous remercie pour votre attention.
Madame Colette.
it. I thank you very much for your intervention and especially the call for more evidence. The need for timely evidence is something we have seen in the tourism sector being an enormous challenge. So far, the sector has very much focused on economic on the economic dimension in measuring its performance. This panel's discussion here today is a proof that this is changing. On behalf of W2, I can inform you that the measurement of sustainable tourism is something very high on the agenda, and that both at the national level, international level, and at destination level. Providing the evidence is, in the end, bringing the transparency to our actions, which is needed to understand where we can prioritize our policy actions the right way. And I like especially your comments related to the different transportation elements of the tourism value chain, which have their difficulties in providing the necessary and timely evidence. And it is something where we at WTO, but also through the One Planet, Planet Initiative, will focus very much over the next month to improve over there the flow of information and the evidence which is guiding then our action. I thank you very much for your intervention, and I take now the opportunity to ask Ms. Anjali Pomponneau, the CEO of the Seychelles Conservation and Climate Adaptation Trust, to deliver her remarks.
Hello? Okay, great, it's working. Good afternoon, everyone. Principal Secretary Wills Agricole from the Department of Climate Change and Energy sends his apologies that he cannot be at this event with you, but I hope I can provide some key useful information about what the government of Seychelles, as well as other local stakeholders, are doing to transform tourism for climate action. I thought I'd start off with some background to tell you a little bit about my island home. So we are a very small population of 95,000 people, and every year we welcome more than 350,000 people to our shores. They come to our isolated islands in the Indian Ocean to enjoy its natural beauty, its mountains, its ocean, its sand. And of course, the good culture and hospitality of the people of Seychelles. It is the main driver of our economy. It brings jobs, revenue, economic growth, but we've all heard that it is also contributing to carbon dioxide emissions. Nevertheless, we are in a conundrum, and the challenge requires strong leadership. It also requires perhaps making some unpopular political decisions. Nevertheless, Seychelles, as a small island developing state, squarely faces this challenge every single day, bearing in mind that a number of jobs and livelihoods are so dependent on the tourism sector. We know if there's an economic crisis in countries that we're so dependent from tourists from, we hear lots of complaints from our local service providers, from people about how their livelihoods are being affected. This is especially true for the service industry, which is often, many of the jobs there are jobs performed by women and by young people. So here we have a very specific group that is becoming even more vulnerable to this. But at the same time, we acknowledge that we benefit from tourism, but its impacts means that sea level rise invades our shores, erratic weather patterns, and the impacts of climate change continue to affect our country. It seems that we are pretty much in catch 22. So how do we strive the balance? The Seychelles is doing quite a lot and is committed to grappling with this challenge and taking concrete steps. So for this part, I'd like to share a little bit about what the government of Seychelles and other stakeholders are actually doing on the ground. It is no coincidence that the former Minister of Environment of the Seychelles, Minister Didier Doglé, is actually now the Minister of Tourism, Civil Aviation and Ports. It's showing this need for leadership, environmental leadership, to transform and be mainstream across the other line ministries. The Seychelles supports the full implementation of the carbon offsetting reduction scheme for International Aviation, CORSIA, which was launched at the last assembly in 2016 of ICAO. And here the scheme represents civil aviation industry's bold efforts to reduce the impacts of civil aviation activities on the environment and address climate change issues. Again, the Seychelles Civil Aviation Authority remains committed to its mandate and enforces on the needs to strengthen the efforts to preserve the environment and heritage. They have already established a structure as part of monitoring in relation to carbon emissions under CORSIA by working with the national carrier of the Seychelles to guide and ensure compliance, capture data, and focus towards the scheme. I don't know how many of you have enjoyed a lovely flight on Air Seychelles, but I'll tell you a little bit about what Air Seychelles is currently doing. Yes, we do have our own national airline. So far, the national airline, Air Seychelles, will invest in a series of electric equipment to reduce fuel dependency on its ground operations. And the arrival of the new Airbus A320neo aircraft offers a range of environmental benefits. This is a small island state actually making investment in our tourism industry. According to the airline, the new engine option aircraft has on average generated 20% fuel savings per flight in 1 month. So it's not just good for the environment, but it's good for the economy as well. In addition to that, we know that there's another driver that makes a demand on fossil fuel, and that, of course, is plastic waste, as well as other forms of waste that continues to choke Mother Earth. Air Seychelles has announced that the national airline has started to implement a new concept on board its jet fleet aircraft as part of an ongoing sustainability efforts to gradually introduce new initiatives to tackle aluminium and plastic waste. So it's considering a pre-plating concept, and this new concept, it estimates, will substantially reduce the total waste collected on board the aircraft with a total weight saving of around 50 kilograms in plastic and aluminium. So the Air Seychelles continues to do its best, and we will keep you abreast of how things develop as new initiatives arise. Although Seychelles strives to be this sustainable destination, these destinations where tourists are invited to participate in sustainable practices, from very small steps such as eating seasonal fruits at breakfast rather than opting for strawberries or grapes, which we don't have at home, locally grown. So we have to import all of this for the convenience and comforts of our foreign visitors. So we do advise and encourage them to engage in sustainable practices whilst they're in the Seychelles. But that said, it remains challenging because we know no matter how many mango trees or papaya trees, it's not sufficient to feed thrice our population. So what we require is more than promoting the concept of a sustainable destination, but where the supply chain is made low carbon and more resilient to climate change, from transportation, accommodation, tourism activities, food and beverage services. But we have been pushing for low carbon tourism and emphasizing the role of industry. For example, hotels, in particular large hotels, so more than 50 rooms, are being pushed to become what we call the Seychelles Sustainable Tourism Label certified. So this is where they are. These large hotels are encouraged to meet certain, well, they must meet certain criteria to do with water resource management, waste management, in order for them to become certified, as well as engaging in conservation efforts. But there's another challenge there, and it was touched upon as well by the former speaker. But we have these hotels with big brands like the Hilton, for example, where they are able to measure their carbon emissions and how their activities are contributing to emissions. However, this is not the case for smaller establishments, 6 rooms, 7 rooms. And you might think, well, perhaps it doesn't even matter because it's only 6 or 7 rooms. But when you put all the small establishments together, you actually find that there's quite a huge footprint. But how do we get this capacity and tools to be translated to smaller establishments? And there, of course, is a need for capacity building internationally as well as locally. In addition to that, the government of Seychelles is considering other finance solutions, such as up to 200% business tax reductions on expenditures by hotels who obtain this SSTL certification. They are also creating greater awareness for the use of corporate social responsibility to fund biodiversity conservation projects, as well as improving enforcement to sanction any harmful practices by tourism operators. I think it's also very important to realize and to appreciate that this sector is also being driven by the consumers. So the Seychelles knows that a lot more consumers, a lot more tourists are sustainability oriented, and they are thinking about sustainability. And in fact, many of our tourism marketers are asked, can you tell us which hotels are sustainable before we book for our holiday in the Seychelles? So, you know, these are very relevant considerations. But at the same time, we have a local NGO, the Seychelles Sustainable Tourism Foundation, that is embarking on an advocacy and education campaign called Pristine Seychelles. They're on Instagram if you want to get some lovely photos of the Seychelles, Pristine Seychelles, to raise awareness about the importance of protecting Seychelles' pristine environment whilst holidaying. But I think, and you know, I also sit on negotiations, and a lot of it comes down to finance. A lot of it comes down to finance. But one of the things that's quite interesting is we've actually explored recently the possibility of willingness to actually contribute by our tourists. Recently, just a couple of months ago, a research was commissioned by the trust fund that I head, which found that 80% of tourists are actually willing to pay an environmental levy between $10 to $40 should be channeled towards environmental challenges and addressing the impacts of climate change. So I just want to put this into perspective. Let's say we don't go for the $40 per person. Let's say we go for the $20 fee. That would raise $6 million in additional financing to address environmental and climate challenges. So here we go. We have a potential financial option. Besides, the tourists come exactly for this, right? To enjoy our coral reefs, to enjoy our healthy and clean oceans, so why not reinvest in it? But that said, I say this with a caveat, tourism remains a competitive industry. Will $40 or $20 extra prevent tourists from coming to the Seychelles? I'm told that I have only 2 minutes left, so I'll end here. Small island developing states are really trying their best. We have many ideas that we're piloting, but we know we don't have all the answers. And we hope to work together with different partners, industry, people, tourists, all of you, to be able to find progressive action towards a climate resilient tourism industry. Thank you.
Ms. Pomponeau, I thank you very much for your remarks, and given the importance tourism has in your industry, and to hear the lines of actions, the wide lines of actions, what we want then here through this panel also to emphasize is that some of these lines of actions are more important than others, because in the end we are limited in resources, and if we ask for a transformation, we have to prioritize. One of the very important elements we have discovered in WTO is to provide timely evidence to our actions so that we see whether an action actually had an impact and had a greater impact than another instrument or another action we have opted for. Is there something where you would say that is an instrument which in the Seychelles right now becomes a priority to help foster this transformation, or to initiate and accelerate this transformation?
It's a challenging question to answer on the spot on behalf of the government of Seychelles. But I think on the whole, it's prioritizing this low carbon supply chain and making it more resilient. So I think we are very much focused on also playing our role in reducing emissions and how we enable our visitors to do that as well. and our service providers.
Thank you very much. I would like now to invite Mr. Carlos Gentile, Secretary of State for Climate Change and Sustainable Development of Argentina, and also the Chair of the Board of Directors of the One Planet Network, to address us.
Thank you very much, and good evening, everybody. So, first of all, I'd like to thank the World Tourism Organization, your environment, and the government of Spain and France for this kind invitation. Secondly, as chair of the board of the 10YFP, that is the framework of production and consumption, 10-year framework of production and consumption, or One Planet Network, I'm glad to be here trying to contribute to fill in the gap between climate change and resource efficiency. It's quite clear to all of us that climate conditions constitute a key factor in the tourist destinations when conditioning the calendar of event, the operational infrastructure, and the well-being of the visitors. Today, I'd like to briefly share with you some insights from Argentina about this issue. The tourist sector in Argentina represents 5.4% of total employment. It's really important. And in some areas, like Andean Forest, it reaches up to 73% of the employment. So you can see what is the importance of the tourism. And another, like Iguazu Falls, that Ovais, I think, had the opportunity to visit last year, 2 years ago in G20, have 65% of the total employment of the region. So it's quite important. It also represents 8% of the national exportation. It is the fourth place in exports in Argentina. And have recently became the first Latin American or South American tourism destination. So tourism sector is very important in Argentina. Based on some studies developed in the framework of our third national contribution communication, it's estimated that in the near future, certain destinations will be affected with a redirection towards different tourist offers, modifying the seasonality of certain tourist destinations. If we can see the map in the northeast, in warmer areas, the temperature increase could also increase stress condition and lack of comfort, increase of risk of heart disease, especially in the individuals exposed to heightened temperatures and change in altitude. In the northeast, increase of frequency and risk of flooding is expected in the area of greater rainfall known as littoral. On the other hand, in the west, center west, in mountain areas, constitute one of the most vulnerable systems to climate change. This will reduce the thickness and the snow cover surface over 2,000 meters of altitude, and this could mean a negative impact on the direction of the ski season, on the reduction of ski areas, especially in low altitude and low latitude centers. How we are managing that? We have created 4 years ago a National Cabinet of Climate Change. It was very important because for us it was a possibility to cross-cutting all the ministries of the cabinet working together with climate change. This cabinet involves almost all the national ministers and is chaired by the chief of cabinet of the president. So during these 4 years, the first we started doing is to review our NDC. Argentina was the first country reviewing our NDC and presenting a more ambitious one at the end of 2016. And we took all the measures that are 70 measures of this NDC and created seven sectorial climate change plans. one of these sectorial plans is the plan of industry, and we put into industry all that has to do to see with tourism. We have a secretary of tourism. In this industry plan, we divided the strategy in three sectors, three axes. Two of the axes are focused in offer of tourism, and one of the axes is focused in consumption, consumers. Regarding regarding the offer of tourism, we divided in the existing tourist destinations, and we studied how climate change is affecting existing tourist destinations. And we focused in three main areas. One is the coastal zones, especially the Atlantic zones, that is mainly affected by rising sea level. The other is urban centers that is mainly affected by thermal stress. And the other one is ski centers. As I mentioned, is snow and that suffered for lost and of snow thickness, and glaciers as well that is suffering for drought. In the other side, we are projecting research in the projected destinations, trying to ensure that investments contemplate climate risk. And finally, focusing in the consumers, we are making some research about transport and comfort of the tourists. To conclude, I find that sustainable tourism is an area with strong links between climate change and resource efficiency, where existing expertise and knowledge that are available in the One Planet Network can be leveraged for strengthening climate initiatives, promoting capacity building, and facilitating access to technical and financial assistance. I think that One Planet Network could work together with the convention in order to make, to fill in this gap between climate change and resource efficiency. In order to move forward at the national level, we will need to keep on working on the improvement of climate analysis as key instrument to make better decisions in the tourism industry and improve the development of tools to analyze future scenarios in order to provide suppliers with serious climatic analysis, which will help them to adapt new circumstances and climate demands. And of course, we will have to do a big research in mitigation, trying to measure emissions impact of the touristic sector. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Gentile, very much, especially for your recommendation to continue the work with UNFCCC. I have now the pleasure to invite Ms. Isabel Oliver, Secretary of State for Tourism of Spain, to deliver her remarks.
Gracias. Muy buenos días a todos. Gracias a la OMT por la organización de este panel tan, tan interesante que ha sentado en esta mesa pues, a personas con muchas aportaciones, ¿no? Esperamos también que podamos nosotros aportar. Es un placer para mí participar en este panel. Está claro que la industria tiene que trabajar y aportar a la lucha contra el cambio climático. Y si hablamos de industria y estamos en España, la industria turística es la principal industria de este país. Ocupa a muchísimas personas, tiene una aportación enorme al PIB. En algunas de nuestras zonas turísticas es importantísimo, llegando a sumar casi el 45% del PIB. Y es, en definitiva, un sector muy, muy importante para nuestro país. Y por ello, por supuesto, no puede ser ajena esta industria tan importante a los grandes desafíos globales que estamos viendo y que se han planteado precisamente en esta mesa. como son la protección del medio ambiente, la reducción de huella de carbono, cómo no, y el desarrollo sostenible. La sostenibilidad no solo como un imperativo moral, sino como una necesidad. Y este concepto, el gobierno del Estado en funciones en este momento, lo tiene absolutamente interiorizado y lo ha asumido como una prioridad. Así es que se ha oído también en esta mesa, el turismo es un concepto, es una industria absolutamente transversal que afecta, por supuesto, a turismo, a mi Secretaría de Estado, a la Secretaría de Estado en la que ahora mismo estoy desempeñando, pero también afecta a todo el gobierno desde muy distintas ópticas. Por supuesto, al Ministerio de Transición Ecológica, por supuesto, también en toda la parte de conectividad, fomento, transformación, toda la maquinaria del gobierno está impregnada y está trabajando sobre esta cuestión. Tenemos muy claro que turísticamente podemos seguir creciendo y tenemos que seguir creciendo, aun siendo el segundo país en número de llegadas y en gasto y el más competitivo del mundo, según el Foro Económico Mundial, pero tenemos que hacerlo de forma responsable, ética y sostenible. Así pues, esta Secretaría de Estado, en el tiempo que hemos estado trabajando, nos hallamos inmersos en la transformación de este modelo de crecimiento turístico de España hacia uno más sostenido y sostenible. Por ello, hemos realizado a principios de este año unas directrices generales de la Estrategia de Turismo Sostenible 2030 para España, que marcan el camino de este nuevo modelo de crecimiento, menos centrado en los números y más en aspectos relacionados con la sostenibilidad de esta actividad turística. Sostenibilidad en sus tres vertientes. Nos interesa la parte económica, por supuesto que sí, pero no menos importante es la social y mucho más importante, diría yo también, la medioambiental. Una sostenibilidad entendida en el sentido amplio, no solo va a mejorar nuestra propuesta de valor al mercado, sino que también aumentará nuestra calidad de vida y va a contribuir a hacer nuestro país un lugar más próspero, más igualitario y más inclusivo, objetivos que sin duda perseguimos. Estas directrices proponen un modelo de crecimiento apoyado en la mejora de la rentabilidad a través de la calidad y la adaptación tecnológica permanente, en la preservación de los valores naturales y culturales y en la distribución equitativa de los beneficios y las cargas del turismo. Y es que este nuevo modelo de crecimiento turístico debe superar problemas que nos acechan, como por ejemplo la pérdida de identidad de destinos, la saturación de los espacios o la contaminación ambiental. Y para lograr este crecimiento sostenido y sostenible, esta estrategia en la que estamos trabajando propone cinco ejes que son la gobernanza colaborativa, el crecimiento sostenible, transformación competitiva y la rentabilidad del sistema, personas, empresas y territorio y, por último, producto e inteligencia turística. También esta nueva estrategia nacional de turismo está, por supuesto, plenamente alineada con la Agenda 2030 y comprometida con la consecución de los 17 Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible. Porque si se planifica y gestiona con responsabilidad, el turismo tiene potencial para ser un instrumento para alcanzar la igualdad, la inclusión, el trabajo digno, la conservación de los ecosistemas y el patrimonio y la repoblación o la cohesión social. Y es que, aunque el turismo solo aparece expresamente mencionado en tres de ellos, el 8, el 12 y el 14, tiene capacidad para influir en la consecución de todos ellos. Así, por ejemplo, en el ODS 11, que busca que las ciudades y las comunidades sean inclusivas, seguras y sostenibles. Y en este sentido, contribuimos a esta meta a través de la red de destinos turísticos inteligentes, un proyecto pionero a nivel mundial que se enmarca en nuestra estrategia integral de apoyo a la mejora de la competitividad y la sostenibilidad de los destinos. Debemos impulsar, y estamos trabajando en ello, en la plena utilización de todas las capacidades tecnológicas en pos de una gestión más sostenible a todos los niveles, en los destinos, porque es allí donde la actividad turística tiene un mayor impacto, tanto en la ciudadanía como en el uso del espacio público, los servicios municipales o la movilidad. España está también comprometida con la producción y el consumo sostenibles, y prueba de ello es que lideramos junto con Francia el programa One Planet, creado por Naciones Unidas para promover la implantación en el sector del ODS-12. Este programa, en el que trabajamos de forma decidida, busca influir en gobiernos, destinos y empresas turísticas a nivel mundial para reducir el impacto del turismo sobre el medio ambiente a través de la reducción del uso de recursos naturales y de la producción de residuos. España tiene con esta iniciativa la oportunidad y responsabilidad también de liderar el cambio hacia un turismo sostenible, turismo más sostenible, que no comprometa el disfrute del planeta por parte de generaciones futuras. Esta responsabilidad, entendemos sin duda, es un reconocimiento a la excelencia e influencia de España como potencia turística mundial. No quiero olvidarme de nuestro compromiso firme con el cuidado de nuestros océanos, fuente de riqueza y uno de nuestros principales atractivos turísticos. España tiene más de 8.000 kilómetros de costa, un activo turístico enorme que hoy por hoy tenemos que conservar para el disfrute actual de nuestros visitantes y también, por supuesto, para el de nuestros residentes. Por eso, el desarrollo del turismo costero y marítimo debe formar parte de una ordenación de las zonas costeras a fin de ayudar a conservar y preservar unos ecosistemas frágiles y servir de vehículo para promover la economía azul. Desde esta Secretaría de Estado tenemos claro que es esencial trabajar en esta dirección y por ello somos parte activa del grupo de trabajo interministerial denominado Innovación para la Economía Azul, que lidera el Ministerio de Ciencia, Innovación y Universidades. Porque es necesario que todas las administraciones trabajemos juntas y dediquemos esfuerzos a esta tarea de protección y conservación. Trabajo entre administraciones, entre el propio gobierno y entre las administraciones y el sector privado, esencial. España es un país líder mundial en turismo y estamos dispuestos a defender esta posición desde la competitividad, la calidad y el apoyo al sector y el compromiso con la consecución de los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. En este camino somos necesarios todos, administraciones públicas, sector privado y, por supuesto, la sociedad civil. Todos debemos implicarnos en el desarrollo sostenible del turismo y en la protección del medio ambiente, porque solo juntos podemos afrontar este reto. Porque el futuro no solo está en lo material que dejamos en el planeta, sino en lo que heredarán nuestras generaciones futuras. Depende de todos nosotros, tenemos esta responsabilidad y esta cimera, esta conferencia es un punto importante en este camino, pues trabajar juntos para conseguir los retos que nos hemos marcado. Muchísimas gracias.
Ms. Olivier, thank you very much for this very clear statement of transforming tourism policy. And I think it's exactly that, Mr. Samat, what we wanted to achieve with this event, to invite here policymakers from tourism destinations which are of a certain size and importance and dependence, and stress here that we are committed to not just live up to the current ambition, but to move up to a high ambition scenario, supporting a sustainability across the tourism sector, but also using the force of tourism to stimulate through the consumer experiences sustainability in other areas of work and life. That brings me to the end, and I invite right now the Executive Director of UNWTO, Manuel Butler, to deliver his closing remarks. I wish to thank here publicly also the International Transportation Forum, who partnered with us in elaborating this report, and Amadeus, who supported us with evidence to gain better insights into the aviation sector. After the closing remarks, if time allows, we will then display a video featuring the different industry leaders and their commitments.
Thank you, Dirk. Very briefly, today is a very important day for the tourism sector, as we have released this research result we prepared together with the IFT. Evidence is needed to manage better and to help the tourism sector to transform to action. And as the discussion highlighted, commit to a high ambition scenario so that a transportation-related carbon emission in the tourism sector are not increasing to 5.3%. To leave this very clear, and as the I have stressed at the beginning of our event, these forecasts are based on the current ambitions, on the current ambition. Nothing is preventing us from increasing our efforts, as the panelists impressively demonstrated, transform the current tourism model. Ladies and gentlemen, let me thank the governors of France, Spain, the Seychelles, and Argentina for joining us today for the discussion. All panelists speak for countries with a strong tourist sector. As we have heard, we the will to support this transformation process with the aim to meeting the agreed targets of the Paris Agreement. Governments have set the direction of development and a destination of climate neutrality in the second half of the century. We now need to amplify the discussion with all the stakeholders, especially those of the private sector, so that these objectives are met. The COP25 is an excellent venue to demonstrate that our sector is committed to meet these objectives. Let me also thank especially the Vice Executive Secretary of the UNCCC, Mr. Sarmat, who I commend for his guiding words made on the COP22. Please, Mr. Sarmat, rest assured that this is at the heart of our actions are committed. Thank you very much.
One final word or vote of thanks from the One Planet Sustainable Tourism Program. Thank you very much to UNFCCC for helping us make this side event a reality, and to our colleagues in the One Planet Sustainable Tourism Program, France and Spain, UN Environment for Eco Organization, as well as the Seychelles and Argentina. Thanks to my colleagues for the help all the way through, and to all of you for your interest. Let's please keep in touch. Thank you.
Keep expanding. Climate change is a challenge and we can't face it. Tourist transformation must start today, and transportation is a critical area so that tourists can keep providing opportunities.
CO2 emissions from tourism are transport related, decarbonizing the transport sector must be a part of the solution to reduce tourism's carbon footprint. At the ITF, we are delighted to have contributed to this UN-WTO project with our findings on transport-related CO2 emissions from tourism. This joint work's insights from the cutting edge of both sectors, transport and tourism, will help advance a low-carbon, sustainable tourism sector.
The positive transformation of tourism must be built on data and evidence. We are very committed to industry sustainability, and as a leading travel and technology company in the Dow Jones Sustainability Index, we are also part of the solution. And we are very pleased to have contributed to this study by sharing our data and expertise on world traffic. I strongly believe that by working together with different international organizations, by finding new ways to cooperate across the industry, we can shape a more sustainable future.
We are committed to the climate goals of the United Nations. AIDA was the first company to introduce low emission liquefied natural gas to the cruise industry already in 2018. We will now start using battery systems on board, followed by the first fuel cell in 2021. Furthermore, we are engaged in research projects for zero carbon fuel. Our goal is the climate neutral cruise experience. We want to save the beauty of our planet for the next generations. Mm-hmm.